to discuss in the context of thermal fluctuations in superfluids. The work is done with two students, Sabyasachi and Vivekanand, who are in the audience, and also Sanjay, who's also here. So there are three parts to the story. And this is actually an attempt to look at long-standing phenomena, some of which is fairly well understood, from a new point of view. And once we establish the method, which is ongoing work, we hope to move on to situations which are more exciting and open. But for the moment, the discussion is on the BCS-BC crossover in sort of clean attractive thermosystems. Then look at the impact of disorder and how it drives a superconductor insulator transition. And finally, time permitting, we'll look at how the presence of a trap as in optical lattices creates coexistence of density wave, superfluidity, and so-called band insulating states sort of in the same system. So this is the logic behind what we've tried to do. The primary instability in attractive thermosystems is superfluidity or superconductivity in sort of charged systems. The presence of disorder can lead to fragmentation of this state and suppresses superfluidity. Traps, we will see, tends to create spatial inhomogeneity. Now, whether it be the clean flat system or the disordered one or the trap, the presence of superfluid order sort of allows a reasonable mean-field description of the ground state. It's not perfect, but compared to the repulsive situation, the repulsive Hubbard model, for example, we have much more control and better understanding of the ground state of the attractive problem. Now, so far about the ground state, but if you look at the effect of temperature in the problem, thermal fluctuations, which are, of course, absent at t equal to zero, come to life, and these are fluctuations primarily in the pairing field. That is, when we talk of a mean field, this is the mean pairing field to which the fermions or the electrons are coupled. Now, the fermions don't see only the mean field at finite temperature. There are fluctuations, spatial and temporal, of these fields at finite temperature. And the issue is to understand their impact on physical properties. So, in particular, at strong coupling, we will discover, and this is quite well known earlier also, that the mean amplitude of this pairing field survives to high temperature, but the phases of these pairing fields randomize, leading to a non-trivial correlated state. I mean, this is like the sort of paramagnetic Mott state in the repulsive Hubbard model, where you find gaps or pseudo gaps and no long-range underlying order. And the attempt is to understand these kind of situations. Now, I will not be able to get into experimental details about these three cases. Mohi has shown something yesterday. I'll just show a snapshot today on this BCS-BC problem. Pratap will have an entire talk on disorder-driven superconductor insulator transitions, and you had seen several view graphs on trapped fermions. So there is just a one-page cartoon, three pictures. The first one from Mohit. You saw a much better version of this yesterday, which was a sort of full slide, which shows the BCS-BC crossover in the clean continuum system. This is not a lattice mode, Mohit. This is the continuum problem, where you go from the collective BCS state at weak coupling to this strongly coupled system of pairs at unitarity onto the weakly interacting bosonic system at strong coupling. And what one sort of takes away from here is there are two scales in the problem. One has to do with pair formation. There is a thin dotted, very hard to see line up here in my version of the picture. And if you wish, the ultimate superfluid transition. So we would want to understand or generate this kind of a picture in the context of a lattice model and see what it teaches us. This is what happens to the attractive thermosystem in the presence of increasing disorder. These are experiments on tin nitride, I think, done by Baturina and co-workers, which shows that with progressively increasing disorder, you go from sort of superfluid state, I mean, a metal becoming a superfluid to ultimately an insulator beyond a critical resistivity as the disorder is increased. So this is the SI transition with increasing disorder in this attractive system. And I guess Professor Finkelstein will talk about some aspects of this tomorrow. This is a part of traps. And there are many things which happen in a trap, the, among which one issue is inhomogeneity. You are at the minimum of the potential at the origin, so that's a region of high density. And as you go out, essentially what will happen is you will get a density gradient across the system, and if the potentials are gentle enough, you could imagine sort of mesoscale phases which are attuned to those densities living in those neighborhoods in the trap. Now, whether that shows up or not depends on how rapidly the trap potential is fluctuating. The other aspect to take away from here is there is a one, because there is a one body potential in the background, tendencies to charge ordering, which can show up in the flat system, tend to be penalized in the presence of a potential like this. Now, given this, let's move on to the first part of the story, which is the BCS-BC crossover, and this has sort of three small parts. One is a quick tour of the model, which will help us in both BCS-BC, the disorder case, and the trap. Then we look at the thermal transition, and you go from BCS, how you go from BCS to BC, and the spectral features and pseudo wrap, which are sort of variable properties. Well, a model. So you take the nearest neighbor tight binding problem on a 2D square lattice. This V of I could be either your random potential or the trapping harmonic confining potential. And this is the attractive interaction. The ingredients in the story are, of course, hopping, the trapping or the disorder potential, chemical potential for density control, and the strength of the interaction. The density in the clean problem is not a very important variable except when you go to half filling. So we will examine the clean flat problem for a generic density of order 0.9. But when we go to the trap, densities become inhomogeneous and we have to worry about how, what the distribution looks like. Anyway, given a problem like this, and we would want to study this both at weak, intermediate, and strong coupling, how would you handle the situation? So many things have been done in the past, including DMFT, quantum Monte Carlo, and so forth. Of course, starting with Minkow theory. What you could do is you could decouple this interaction using what is called the Hubbard-Stratlow transformation, which rewrites the two-body interaction in terms of an effective field. There are two ways of doing it. You could do it in terms of effective pairing field coupling to pair operators, of course, including the Hermitian conjugate, or this is a complex scalar, or you could take a real scalar field coupling to a total fermion density at a given site. This would be space-time dependent fields, the deltas and phis, and that converts this interacting problem to quantitative fermions in a space-time dependent background. Typically, you are forced to select one of these decompositions, either this or that, and not both in this spirit. And then you do exact numerics if you're a quantum Monte Carlo person, where you typically take this decomposition and go ahead with the numerics, or you have to make further approximations. Now the difficulty with the single channel but exact numerics is that the quantum Monte Carlo becomes more and more expensive with increasing system size and with lowering temperature. While if you make approximate treatments, then the choice that you've made for the decomposition, whether you've taken the scalar decomposition or the complex scalar decomposition, begins to make a difference to the results that you end up with. And one would want to capture results which, at some level, are independent of this choice, which takes us to the next aspect, that instead of using this single field being constrained by this single field decomposition, if you use something which is a multi-field field decomposition, and this is not an exact Hubbard-Stratlow decomposition, but indeed it has been tried out in the past. The earliest reference I could locate was from 1999. This is Castellani and co-workers, has been reinvented more recently. And to make progress, you retain spatial fluctuations in these fields, in the deltas and the phis, but for the time being, don't worry about the time dependence, because that is a much harder problem. You end up with an Hamiltonian. So your parent model, this object, approximately looks like this. These parts are given, the quadratic parts are given the same as before, but now you have the fermions, sort of pair operators coupling to the pairing field, density coupling to a scalar, let's call it a density field, and these two weight factors for these complex scalar and simple scalar fields, phi and delta. So this is multiple auxiliary fields rather than a single auxiliary field, and the reason to do it is at zero temperature, a formulation like this becomes mean field theory, which where you basically minimize the energy associated with H with respect to the phis and the deltas. And if you do this multiple field decomposition, you automatically reproduce the Hartree-Fock-DDG theory of the parent model. And that I think is an important starting point. Because if you do a single field decomposition, then you miss out, for example, either the Hartree-Fock or this part, and that sort of severely limits the applicability of the theory. It also is the correct symmetry in terms of having the U1 symmetry here, and in fact at half filling it will turn out to have a sort of O3 symmetry, which means you will capture the correct thermal physics at finite temperature. Which classical configurations can you use? So there are these deltas and phis hanging around the story. They're not given to us a priori. If you are doing mean field theory, the zero temperature, you just minimize H with respect to those. If you are at finite temperature, you have to generate the equilibrium configurations of an effective Hamiltonian. The equilibrium configurations of an effective phi delta Hamiltonian, which is obtained by tracing all the fermion degrees of freedom. Now that is easier said than done, because the fermions and the classical fields could be strongly coupled to each other. And then you need to get into an iterative process. That is, you take a configuration of these deltas and phis, which may not be an equilibrium configuration. You attempt to make an update. Whether you accept the move or not depends on how the fermion energy reacts to that change in the background fields. So you compute the cost to H naught plus H coupling, add in this part. If you gain energy, you accept. If you lose energy, you accept with the probability, depending on the temperature. So far, so good. It's an expensive process. It's not as expensive as full quantum Monte Carlo, but still it limits you severely in terms of system size. And there are innovations people have come up with in the meantime. So there are so-called polygonal expansion methods which cut down this n power 4 to n power 2. If you make a further approximation and use what are called cluster algorithms, which we use, you can essentially make it an order n method, but with a sort of very large p-factor. Upshot of all this is that after the static approximation for the auxiliary fields and an additional approximation in the numerical algorithm, you can access sizes which are in 2D, something like 40 by 40. 10 cube in a 3D situation. Sorry. Once you equilibrate and your energy has sort of stabilized with equilibrium fluctuations, you can compute correlation functions of the auxiliary fields or the fermions themselves in these equilibrium backgrounds. So essentially, although we don't use this form explicitly, you are generating configurations which are samples of this object, an effective Gibbs-Bode-Landau theory, and solving for fermions in those self-consistent backgrounds. So this is mean field theory promoted to a field theory at finite temperature. What do you keep track of? Well, you keep track of, you can keep track of auxiliary field indicators, like what the deltas are doing. This is like the delta-delta correlation and ultimately leads you to the superfluid structure factor in the problem. You can keep track of spatial maps. What are the deltas doing from site to site, either on single configurations or thermally averaged. You can work out the density of states. You can also work out the optics and the resistivity. Yeah, you keep delta complex and the phi is as real scalars. Okay. And the deltas have both amplitude and phase fluctuations. Now, go back to, now to come back to the sort of results and the background of this story, the earliest attempt at looking at the finite temperature problem in BC is to BC, I think was by Norius and Schmittring. The ground state would have been explored by Leggett, Mohit mentioned it yesterday, but the first attempt at finite temperature and working out the weak coupling and the strong coupling asymptotes was possibly in 84 by these two people. It didn't get this intermediate peak, right? But the two limits are well understood there. These two are more recent results. This is from Miyake and his group, where they use a semi-analytic technique of a self-consistent T-matrix calculation to capture both the weak coupling BCS limit and the strong coupling BEC, done for various values of fermion density. Okay. These are Monte Carlo results from Mohit Nandini co-workers in a recent paper. There are differences. This is a 3D system, this is a 2D system. Unfortunately, I could not get answers for the same dimensionality and the same parameter values. This is for densities roughly, I think, of about 0.8 or 0.9. And what we will try to sort of take away from here, one, there is a peak in the transition temperature at U of order 5, U by T of order 5 from the quantum Monte Carlo. This is 3D, so except for the shape of the curve, we don't want to get into the numbers too much here. The numbers of U's here are at the peak value, the U at which the peak TC occurs, and then a follow the TC itself and see if this compares reasonably with the kind of answers we will get using our formulation. So what we keep track of is something sort of more mundane than what Arun was discussing in terms of the XY model. So we have a model in the XY class. It has an autosymmetry. So we keep track of the auxiliary field correlations and look at the Q equal to zero structure factor related to those deltas. That is how the deltas phase correlate as you reduce temperature. And this is the sort of something, let's call it the ferromagnetic structure factor associated with those deltas as a function of temperature. Now, at U equal to 2, with the black dots, you have some TC, which is maybe 0.08 or so. As you increase the strength of interactions, you, at U equal to 4, there is a significant increase. It goes up here. At 6, it will reduce slightly. And if you go to stronger values, you basically trace out this kind of a curve. You shouldn't look too much at, I mean, between 0 and 2, our system size is not large enough to access the BCS limit well enough. It's more attuned to looking at the stronger correlation limit where coherence lengths are shorter. But the peak occurs somewhere between 4 and 5. And the peak value is, well, maybe 0.1314. And as a gross comparison, we probably are not doing too badly if you compare it to what you get from a full Monte Carlo calculation, which probably says that this thermal transition is driven mostly by classical fluctuations rather than the quantum phase fluctuations of the pairing field. If you look at that, and this would be your 1 by U asymptote. I mean, the real 1 by U comes at larger values of U, but this is the rollover and the quote-unquote strong coupling Heisenberg rule that Anton was talking about yesterday. If you look at the 2 delta by TC limit, 2 delta by TC ratio, even at the lowest value, which we had at 2 here, that ratio is beyond BCS. I mean, we should have got something like 3.2 possibly within the BCS theory. You get a value of 7 at U equal to 2. So you are already beyond BCS at the lowest values of interaction we use, and by the time you go to U equal to 10, these values are enormous. Ultimately, this ratio works like U square by T square at large U, and over much of the phase that the video explored, we are way beyond the BCS limit of the theory. So what more on this one? There is a non-monotonic TC, which we have seen. The gap by TC ratio is large and growing as you go to larger values of U. None of this is surprising. The issue is the method wasn't mean field method at T equal to zero. I mean, we mentioned that U was supposed to minimize this energy, you were minimizing, that's not the way you work, but at T equal to zero, this is a minimization procedure. It's a mean field theory. So how is it that the mean field theory captures any of these, this kind of effects at finite temperature? Well, I think the essential issue is that we, at finite temperature, we are computing the fermion energy in a spatially fluctuating background, which has scales like sort of T square by U built into it, which is not the case with the mean field theory. The mean field theory is trying to track the pair formation scale, which is enormous, and it was given in sort of Mohit's continuum problem. And we don't track, I mean, in principle, we could track that kind of a scale also. We would see it in when we look at the gap structure of the story. But this has to do with the fermion energy difference between a fully sort of phase-ordered state and an amplitude form but phase-disordered state. That energy is T squared by U, and that energy is well computed because you're exactly diagonalizing for the energy of the fermions in that spatially fluctuating background. So this is something which is DDG and beyond. DDG at T equal to zero, at zero temperature, these results are well known. So the black curves in all three of them correspond to the ground states. And you see there is a small and progressively growing gap as you go from 2 to 6 to 10. There are covalence peaks at the bandwidth having to do with propagation in the phase order background. These sort of oscillations are finite size. So even at E equal to 2 for sizes which are like 24 to 30 square that we use here, there are still finite size oscillations which dampen out with rising temperature. And essentially one could say that at E equal to 2 with rising temperature, you go from a superfluid with its gap and coherence peaks to a gapless quote-unquote thermoliquid above TC. In the U equal to 6 case, which is at intermediate coupling, you are close to the hump in this PC curve, the graph begins to narrow and looks or forms something like a pseudo gap close to omega equal to 0 at the highest temperature, which is maybe thrice TC at U equal to 6. While if you go to U equal to 10, the single particle density of states has a gap which shrinks with temperature. We will see how it shrinks in the next geograph, but never quite closes. So this is superfluid to thermoliquid, ungapped phase, superfluid to a pseudo gap, and superfluid to a fully gapped phase at or about the TC. Now it was beyond DDG because DDG would not have captured, by its very construction, it doesn't worry about phase fluctuations. And at least in these two cases, here it is completely phase fluctuations, here it is amplitude and phase, here it is mostly amplitude fluctuations that are responsible for the renormalizations of the density of states with rising temperature. And you begin to see sort of physics beyond DDG and the power of the method sort of showing up here. Okay. Yes.
You look at a snapshot of some.
Yes. Yes.
Do you see what this is?
I think we need better resolution. What is this in the configurations of the deltas you are talking about? Yes. We have not looked carefully enough. But, I mean, if this is a model in the XY class, and it is an XY-like model, particularly at strong coupling, with enough resolution, one should be able to see it.
What about the phi field? How does it?
The phi field is a spectator in this problem. The phi field, the phi field is truly important in the disordered case, which Mohit and sort of students have worked out.
No.
This phi is fluctuating. Okay. But the dominant fluctuations in the clean problem are actually coming from the deltas and not so much the phis. The phis will become a mean value in the disordered case, but even the thermal fluctuations are not very important in the phis.
So your approximation is that you've come from the core independence
of these fields.
So you expect
it
systematically overestimates TC?
I guess it would overestimate TC.
You see
that? You need data of a better quality, possibly from Monte Carlo, to be able to say that. They could give us something. Is there data with sort of smaller error bars in the Monte Carlo, is it? This is a 2D Monte Carlo.
Cannot do ODLR, you actually have to look at the Nelson bar and jump in the
Okay.
And given the system sizes, the system doesn't. In 2D.
Yeah.
3D one can definitely do better.
Do better. I mean, we can certainly do our calculation in 3D as well. So at the moment, we don't know, but I mean, qualitative, yes, we would be overestimating. Then when do I close?
Before
the close. Huh? 20 minutes. Okay. Okay, so on this density of state story, you lose coherence, not surprisingly, lose the coherence peaks with increasing temperature. Black to whatever this color is, violet. Then also if you notice, on temperature scales which are like 0.1 units of T, there is spectral heat transfer over an enormous energy window. Whereas this scale is U by 2 basically. And there is a rate transfer occurring from here to here, from beyond the Hubbard band edge, the upper edge of the Hubbard band, to sub-black regions on temperature changes which are 1/10 of the Hopping scale in the problem. And the crude explanation is that these are electrons moving in the background of these large deltas, but with phase randomness, and the phase and the disorder in these objects acts like a broadening of the density of states, spilling outward. And because the phase stiffness is small, phases randomize at low temperature, and as a consequence of the phase randomness, the electron propagation sees a highly disordered background with spills over weight over a huge energy scale. In fact, you would see this also in optics, which will come to later, not just in the density of states. Now, if there are these features of a gap, a pseudo-gap, and an ungapped high-temperature phase, you can more organize this in terms of the phase diagram, sort of. So, you've already seen the transition temperature, which is drawn by a firm line here. The superconductor, of course, is gapped. Now, we are trying to characterize these phases up to a moderate temperature, not all the way up, in terms of whether the high temperature phase is ungapped, pseudo-gapped, or gapped, and it turns out that there is a curved line, this is not completely vertical, somewhere beyond U equal to 4 is the, in the 2D case, is a fully gapped region. That is, if you look at the eigenvalue spectrum over sort of maybe 100 snapshots, you don't see, I mean, there could be exponentially small width, but to all our measurement resolution, we can't look at any density of states in this window. While here, you see pictures which have this kind, maybe sometimes sharper pseudo gap. While on the left-hand side, modulo finite size effects, you see essentially an ungapped feature. What do the gaps do with temperature? Well, if you are somewhere here at U equal to 2, you go up in temperature, the gap essentially closes, zero, at T of order Tc. If you look at U equal to 6, which was somewhere here, there is a narrow gap, which looked like a pseudo gap, which survives to high temperature. If you are at U equal to 10, which is a strong coupling limit, there is a strong diminution of the gap. The gap is, so it's true that amplitudes are frozen, are large, but the phases being random leads to spectral wave transfer, and the gap reduces to something like 1/3 its zero temperature value by the time you are at T by Tc of order 3. So there is a strong temperature dependence of the gap, but no closure if you are in the strong coupling limit. We are trying to work out the resistivity and the optics in the clean case. We have problems with the sun rules which would need to sort out. And once we do that, we can talk sort of meaningfully about what happens to this so-called two-particle property as a function of temperature and do. But for the moment, let me move on to this story of the impact of disorder on this superconducting problem. Okay. Yeah. Any? Yes. 0.9. No, 3 is important. So at density 1, I'll get density wave degeneracy with superfluidity. In fact, the reason for keeping the phi in the story is that you also want to capture the charge density wave. Okay. So at in the flat case at n equal to 9, I need not have bothered about this density or instability at all. But once I go to the trap, my density is becoming homogeneous, and I need to have a mechanism where the density instability is part of the story. Yes. Are you telling me that you should see signatures of the density wave instability in the proximity of n equal to 1? You're right. I think we should put an impurity in this problem. Okay. If you put, let's say, potential scatterer, maybe it creates a density fingerprint around it, which has this checkerboard kind of pattern. We haven't seen it in this model yet, but I suspect as you go close to n equal to 1, these kind of tendencies are going to be amplified. Okay. But in these snapshots, we haven't seen anything very significant yet. So, sort of three parts of the story once again. What happens to the transition temperature? What happens to the spectral features across the disorder-driven SIP? That is, suppose you are at a given temperature and some of the sample could be taken to progressively higher degrees of disorder. What happens to your density of states? What happens to your optics, resistivity, etc.? And our spatial maps, because people have started doing spatially resolved tunneling measurements. Petup does it at TIFR and various people elsewhere in the world. And maybe want to begin to look carefully at what temperature does to the spatial maps and the frequency dependence of those maps. So this, I mean, unfortunately, the x-axis, the y-axis here has been normalized to PC0. So at U equal to this is three values of U, weak, intermediate, and strong. This is my TC curve. It has a peculiarity of a tail, which I'll explain very quickly. And at U equal to the y-axis is normalized by the TC in the non-disordered problem. So here, the actual TC is something like 0.1 or maybe 0.08. Here, the actual TC is 0.15. And here, it is small once again. We basically should have gone up the hill and climbed down. So 2, 4, and 10, one is normalized by those TCs. And as you increase the degree of disorder, I'm going to use the property again, go back and sort of look at this pairing field correlation function, disorder averaged over maybe 10 or 20 copies, and see where there is an onset, the equivalent of this plot. This plot in the disordered case. And as a practical measure beyond a certain disorder, with the finite number of disorder average, we do not manage to see any TC at all. However, we know something else from early work by Amit Ghoshal, Mohit, and Nandini, that since our theory reduces to DDG at t equal to 0, that theory should have a superfluid ground state of all values of disorder. I mean, irrespective of how large you make the U and the V, the ground state is superfluid, and it should have maybe a very small but finite TC problem. However, in cooling down, it's just a matter of a numerical protocol, we are unable to locate this state. So for the sake of satisfying this, the principle that you cannot have a true quantum transition unless the dynamics of the auxiliary fields is built in, we have put in a tail by hand in this plots. But effectively, beyond U, beyond V, which is like maybe 1.6 here, something similar, and smaller with progressively larger values of U, we do not see a superfluid transition. We do not see a superfluid phase, which although in principle it exists. Now that's a sort of artifact of the approximation that we made. However, you could go and cross. That is, if you come down like this, you could claim that you always get a superfluid at lower temperatures, but you could go across the thermal transition, take cuts like this at finite temperature, and that would be a genuine superconductor or superfluid to insulator transition, and we will see some results on dynamical properties as you do that. Now to run through this quickly, this is n equal to 0.9, as I mentioned to Arun. The disorder is drawn from a box distribution of a certain width V. initial state, meaning this framework should be always superfluid, and this tails are just to sort of keep that in place. And these things are averaged over maybe sometimes 10, sometimes 20 copies of disorder. Now this is, I think, a very important plot. This is from Amit Goshal's work with more than Amini, which shows that if you take, so the DBG state itself doesn't care about phases. It essentially locks phases in parallel. But you can do a stiffness calculation on top of that. And you notice that this is, of course, at a smaller value of u. This is at minus 1.5, which is close to 2 in what we were doing. With increasing disorder, the so-called DBG phase stiffness drops sharply, but has a tail that I presume goes to arbitrary large, that is a v. It never hits 0. However, if you do a quantum phase fluctuation, a self-consistent calculation on top of this state, you'll discover that at a v of order, maybe 1.7 or so, this object hits 0. So a genuine quantum transition from a superfluid to a insulating phase will have to build in the dynamics of the auxiliary fields into the story. But if you're looking at transitions at finite temperature, or you are trying to get a feel for where this critical point lies, I think this curve, the dotted curve on top, already gives you an impression of where the underlying quantum transition is going to take place. Now this was DDG plus sort of two levels of calculations pinpointing the transition. There is sort of very careful Monte Carlo calculation by, again, Nandini Mohit and their students, which pins it down through disorder average calculation and shows that indeed at a value, this is at u equal to 4, I guess, not 1.5, you get a quantum transition where the TC scale collapses to 0 here, and something like a pair injection scale comes to life characterizing the insulating phase. Now given that all of this is understood, that BDG gives you a good ground state, and a hierarchy of calculations on top of this can give you a feel for what the stiffness does. That's the one side of the story. The other is you could do a full numerical calculation, which is sign problem independent in the negative U model, and get results of this quality. Why you would want bother for another kind of an approximation in the story? The point about this is the stiffness calculation by itself doesn't tell you what the TC is going to be. In fact, the profile of the TC probably is somewhat different from what the profile of the stiffness is as a function of disorder. And two, you don't have access to the electronic state itself at finite temperature, although you know at what value of disorder the system is going to be insulating. In other words, if you look at the clean problem, these arose from phase fluctuations on top of the BDG state. So we know those fluctuations exist. This calculation tells me the stiffness associated with those fluctuations, but their feedback on the electronic spectrum is not very easy to incorporate. So while the quantum Monte Carlo does give you information about the state, but in terms of imagined rate and data, which of course has been inverted in terms of spectral information in this paper, but if you go to things like two particle properties like optical density of states, etc., it becomes progressively more complicated. So the virtue that one could argue for in a method like this is that given a sort of integrated method, it gives you access to the meaningful ground state, hopefully reasonable, and captures fluctuations, which gives you a feel for transition temperatures and spectral properties in a non-trivial part of the phase diagram. So this is about what the electronic state actually looks like as you vary disorder and temperature in the problem. So between 5 minutes, I have 5 minutes. Okay, so I will not be able to get to this trap business at all. So this is weak correlation, u equal to 2 and u equal to 4, and essentially you see that the gap has a non-monotonic behavior with increasing disorder. It will be seen better in slides down the line. And disorder, I mean, okay, let's put it this way. At a given temperature, the gap has a non-monotonic dependence. With increasing disorder, it narrows. It has a minimum close to the transition between superfluid and insulator and widens once again as you go to the right. While as a function of temperature, something that should have been ungapped in the clean limit now begins to pick up a pseudo gap as you sort of heat up the disordered system. The comparison that one should make here is this is equal to 2 in the clean limit, and essentially you had a narrow gap with coherence peaks, the coherence peaks vanished, and the gap also disappeared, and you end up essentially with the tight bonding density of states in the high temperature phase. The same thing now, the same strength of correlation, you raise your temperature and you end up with this kind of, the blue kind of a curve characterizing the high temperature state of the system. While if you're at stronger interaction, this is equal to 4, there is, I should call it a narrow gap rather than a pseudo gap in the density of states. Okay. The resistivity has a profile like this, that is at weak disorder, it is basically metallic, then begins to show an upturn, and okay. So the point to take away from this plots is that if you trust this as characterizing that true resistivity in the problem, there is no clear separatrix between what is the sort of metallic side and the insulating side of the problem. Let me go back to Baturina's plot here. I mean, plotted on a long scale, it seems that I have one family of red curves which look like this and then go downwards, and blue curves which go upwards, but looked at on a linear scale, actually, this curve has an upturn and then goes superconducting. It's not flat, so there doesn't seem to be, at least at the level of this data, a flat universal conductance associated with the transition here. Now, there are approximations which have gone into our calculation, so one doesn't want to make any strong claim, but all that one would say is that if you look at the resistivity data here, there isn't a in that regime. However, if you go up in temperature, it appears that even when the single particle density of states has a gap, and narrowing that close to the transition, so the gap sort of, in fact, I think this is to show, this is data from Mohit and Nandini's work. This is the density of states gap, which is a minimum close to the transition. This is the density of states gap. Okay. It is the minimum close to the transition and sort of increases on either side. Okay. I should have plotted something like that here, but I have the full density of states. Okay. Optical weight, however, so the density, the gap narrows and widens once again, but even when there is a gap in the single particle density of states, the optics seems to have significant weight at low frequencies, frequencies below the corresponding 2 delta. Now this is a feature, this is something one observes at this strength of correlation, you can go to stronger correlations. Numbers reduce in the optical conductivity, but the trend remains, and you can plot that integral over the single particle gap window, from 0 to the single particle gap window, and as a function of disorder, if you plot it at various temperatures, you find the peak in that optical spectral weight close to the V corresponding to the critical disorder. So, at each temperature there is a critical disorder, and as you vary disorder through the transition, it seems that the low frequency optical spectral wave, in some sense in the subgap region of the density of states, has a gap close to VC and falls on both sides. This is true at 2, 4, and one presumes if you do it for other values of correlation, it will turn out to be true there as well. And if you plot the peak temperature, that peak V, the V at which the peak occurs as a function of temperature, it basically matches the phase boundaries. So both at equal to 2 and 4, we plotted that view peak of temperature with respect to temperature, sort of on an inverted scale, and the firm lines are the phase boundaries estimated from the TC. They lie on top of each other. Okay. The two are out of time. Okay. So, yeah, but, okay. So, this is a longer story, it will take its own time. What one can also do, this is a demonstration of what the method can do, is you can look at spatial maps of the pairing field as a function of sort of position, temperature, and various parameters in the problem. You don't measure the pairing field, so one can, of course, calculate electronic properties locally in those neighborhoods. This is the density field, the Ni in the problem. This is done for the metallic side of the superfluid insulated transition. This is done for the insulating side. You notice that, and for the same fingerprints of this order, on the insulating side, there is greater fragmentation of the density pattern, poorer and non-existent phase correlations. This red and the blues basically are oppositely aligned domains in the sample, and averaged over the system, superfluid correlations vanish. So you can do maps of pairing fields, you can do phase correlations, you can do density. You don't measure the density easily. You can also do, I think this is more interesting, the local density of states at various frequencies. This is the subgap frequency, this is the coherence peak frequency, and this is a high frequency, and do it as a function of temperature. And then, I think the issue would be sort of the inverse spectroscopy, that if someone measured something like this as a function of spatial coordinates and temperature, what can you infer about the underlying electronic state from this? Now, let me skip all of this and get to the conclusion. I have not managed to tell you anything about the trap problem, where the intention was to show you that if you put in the confounding potential, you will see coexistence, you could see coexistence of density wave gradients in a certain annulus with a band insulating core, a density wave annulus, and maybe a superfluid region, sort of all living in the same system, and it has interesting spectral signatures and sort of NFK distributions. Now, to bring the story to a close, we have studied the theory of pairing and density fields coupled to fermions. The density fields were brought into the story to particularly to model inhomogeneous situations and the presence of disorder. The theory is just Hartree Fowlby GRT equal to zero. It's not any more powerful or profound than that, but it is the ability of capturing the low energy thermal fluctuations in the story, and simultaneously charge order and superfluidity. And because in some sense it is a real frequency, real time theory, not an imaginary time formulation, it allows you ready access to spectral features and transport. This could be a sort of incentive to investing in a method like this. Now, much of what we have seen till now has been very well captured by other methods, VDG at zero temperature, quantum Monte Carlo at finite temperature. So what else could one do, sort of to push the boundaries of the method? You could study situations with sort of more exotic disorder. You can put in magnetic moments in the problem, periodic arrays of magnetic moments or random magnetic moments in the problem. You can study imbalance systems, okay, sort of mass imbalance or density imbalance possibly. You can study the impact of spin orbit coupling. You can study, just as you look at disorder driven SI transitions, you can look at field driven SI transitions. In fact, one of the earlier works in the problem from Eagle, Meyer and company looks at these kind of issues. Okay. Maybe the presence of vortices, coastal hysteresis vortices, or field-induced abducted structures in the story. And maybe, this is a hope, I don't know how far one can push this, look at issues of dynamics of the condenser, dynamics of this kind of state at finite temperature, if you create initial conditions and let the system evolve. So, thank you.
Maybe I missed it, but did you take into account Coulomb repulsion Because you have a fragmented state.
No, there is no coulomb repulsion.
But you should, right?
Oh, absolutely. You should. There are many other things one should do.
I know, but this is very important because the superconductivity is screwed by.
Yes, yes. If you're heading towards that island kind of phase, okay, there are charging energies involved there. That is where you should take the coulomb into account.
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yes. So in particular, let me go to the picture. You're looking at sort of close to the transition where you mentioned close to the transition where this island kind of structures are the most prominent.
Go away from the transition, go into the insulating phase.
Into the insulating phase.
We have
okay.
Many,
yeah,
islands, we have charging
effects.
Yeah.
That should be there.
Yes.
Yes. There is something screening of the disorder in the system because we are introducing the interaction in the disorder in the system.
Yes.
So due to the interaction, there should be screening of the disorder. And this site transition will depend on both the disorder strength and the value of your on-site person term.
Yes. The starting interaction in the problem is an on-site attraction. What I think Vikram is pointing out is there are in real electronic systems, there are also coulomb repulsions. Okay. And this U is an effective attraction arising from some other origin. So if you're considering charged systems, that effective repulsion is important. Okay. Maybe not so much deep in the metal, but as you head towards the transition and into the insulator, they would be important. And I guess tomorrow we'll hear more about that from Professor Finkelstein. They are important, yes. But the reference calculations I'm talking about in this, which go back to what was done by Amit Ghoshal, etc., themselves don't have those effects built in. So if I'm trying to benchmark a method at this moment, not explain experiments, which are the next step, I'm just staying with attractive local interactions and disorder, and no repulsion at the moment in the story. Yes.
I think we have run out of time, so let me just continue the discussion.
Thank you.